Good morning, and welcome to the Siganto Foundation Artist Book Seminar for 2015. The theme for today is Artist Books and Performance. Firstly, I acknowledge the traditional owners of this land, the Turrbal people and the Yugara people, and pay respects to their ancestors who came before them. The location of the State Library on Kurilpa Point was historically a significant meeting, gathering, and sharing place for Aboriginal people. We proudly continue this tradition today. My name is Christine Drew, and I'm one of the librarians that works with the Australian Library of Art Collections, one of which is the Artist Book Collection here at the State Library of Queensland. I'll be convening today's seminar. I would like to welcome our guests this morning, Dr. Marie Siganto, AM, Director of the Siganto Foundation, Jeanette Wright, CEO and State Librarian, Professor Amir Brito Cadôr, academic and artist who is visiting from Brazil to give our keynote address, the Siganto Foundation Fellows, Jan Davis, Doug Spoward, Julie Barrett and Clyde McGill. My colleagues Helen Cole, the coordinator of the Australian Library of Art, and Beck Kilner are currently on leave. Beck is here with us this morning, and I expect that Helen will join us at some stage today. I would also like to acknowledge Helen's work in developing the Artist Book Collection over the past 22 years. Her knowledge, scholarship, professionalism, and dedication is to be applauded, as the State Library has a very fine and renowned artist book collection. Also joining us today later will be director Floyd Kennedy and performers from QUT, Thomas Yaxley, Emily Weir and Megan Clark. We also will have Louise Martin Chu to convene our panel discussion this afternoon. Finally, ladies and gentlemen, thank you for your attendance today, and I do hope that you are able to enjoy the Artist Book Seminar for 2015. So before we get started with the program, there's some housekeeping points that we need to cover. Emergency exits are located at the back and front of this auditorium. Should we need to have an evacuation, please wait for instruction from State Library fire wardens, and they will be identified because they will have hard hats and fluoro vests. The assembly points for us are the Art Gallery Plaza in this direction and Kurilpa Park up to the north. Water fountains are located to the left of the entrance to the reading rooms on levels 2-3, and on level 4 they're behind the Talbot Family Treasures Wall. Toilets are located immediately opposite the auditorium here. So the program for today will include the announcement of the successful applicants for the second round of Siganto Foundation Fellowships. We will be having a keynote address by Amir Brito Cadôr, and his title of his paper is The Book as Performance. We'll then be having some reports from our Creative and Research Project Fellows, Doug, Jan, Clyde and Julie. After lunch, we'll be having some performances. So Amir will be performing Momento Vital, and it is by a Brazilian artist, Vera Chavez Barcelos. QUT students Tom Yaxley, Emily Weir and Megan Clark will be performing Robert Bringhurst's polyphonic poem, New World Suite No. 3, a poem in four movements for three voices. We'll then have a panel discussion and on collaborative art practice, and then to end today's session, Julie and Virginia Barrett will perform Julie's artist book, The Morning After, and then Clyde McGill, who's also a Siganto Fellow, will provide the last performance for the day of his work, Enso. So there we have it. We've got a fairly full program, and I do hope that everything goes to plan and you enjoy the program. I'd now like to introduce Jeanette Wright, our CEO and State Librarian. Jeanette's going to open the seminar today and introduce Marie Siganto. Thank you, Jeanette.
Thank you, Christine. Good morning, everyone, and you are very much in the dark this morning. I'd like to welcome you all here to the State Library of Queensland today to celebrate and explore the significance of artists' books. But I'd like to also acknowledge the traditional owners of the land here where the State Library is situated and pay my respects to their ancestors who came before them and to elders still living today. We are very proud to continue their tradition of acknowledging traditional owners when we welcome people to this land here at Kurilpa Point. It is a traditional meeting place that's been used by the local Indigenous people as a meeting place for thousands of generations. First, I'd like to begin by thanking Dr. Marie Siganto for being with us today. And it's a pleasure to have you here, Marie. And we're very appreciative of the Foundation's support, the Siganto Foundation's ongoing support for the Australian Library of Art at the State Library. Marie will speak to us about the Siganto Foundation's continuing promotion of art, and in particular, artists' books in Queensland. As many of you know, the Australian Library of Art here at State Library is an internationally renowned collection and resource for artists, writers, designers, bookbinders, collectors, historians, botanists, and many others. I like to refer to it as our Museum of the Book, or it's the book as artifact collection. And it's the home to one of Australia's most significant collections of artists' books. It's one of the largest in Australia. It comprises about 1,500 works featuring both Australian and international artists. And we define artists' books as artworks that use the form or a concept of a book. So it's free from the constraints of traditional publishing. Artists' books can take many forms. They can be handcrafted or commercially printed. They can be unique or in limited or unlimited editions. The collection contains items of a traditional codex through to sculptural works, or they may have audio, video, installation, online and performance components, some of which you'll hear about this morning. Furthermore, the fluid nature of artists' books allows artists to touch on varied and diverse subject matter. Since 2000, Dr. Marie Siganto has supported the State Library of Queensland, both serving on the Library Board of Queensland and through the financial support from the Siganto Foundation. This support has allowed the Australian Library of Art to increase awareness of our collection and encourage the work of artists in this space. The State Library has been able to host workshops with internationally renowned book artists, run free seminars such as today's, and offer creative and research fellowships. In 2015, four fellowships were awarded in both creative and research disciplines. You'll actually hear from some of those recipients of those fellowships later today. The creative fellowship allows a practitioner to develop a new work based on the State Library collections, while the research fellowship supports a researcher to explore the State Library's artist book collection to generate new knowledge in this field. In this seminar, we hope to continue the discourse about artists' books and to consider the importance of artists' books as performance. And I'm looking forward to Amir's performance after this afternoon. As Christine explained, you'll be treated to a range of different performances as well as research presentations and panel discussions. You'll have the opportunity to hear from past Siganto Foundation Artists Book Fellows, and thanks must go to Doug Spowart, Jan Davis, Julie Barrett and Clyde McGill for sharing their insights and inspiration with us. And this afternoon, as I said, you'll be treated to musical and artistic performances from QUT students, including director Floyd Kennedy, Thomas Yaxley, Emily Weir and Megan Clark. I hope you find the program inspiring and stimulating, and I hope you'll all leave today with a better understanding and a deeper appreciation of the world of artists' books. I encourage you to return tomorrow to explore the Artist Book Fair, which will be downstairs in the Knowledge Walk on Level 1 of the State Library from 10 a.m. And you'll be given an opportunity to take home your own artwork created by local artists, bookmakers. So I'd now like to introduce Dr. Marie Siganto, AM, member of the Siganto Foundation.
I too would like to acknowledge the original owners of the land, their ancestors and elders, and also this incredibly important place to them and to us on which we're gathered. Just indulge me for a moment while I say something a little bit personal, and that is, my dad always used to love to be given a microphone, and that was fine, and he used to always say to us, never pass up the opportunity to say a few words. Now, the downside of that was he said the same thing over and over, and people were not only born witless, but there was that sort of, sense of they all had the irrits by the end of the thing. So a moment later, I'm going to sort of launch into things that I have said before, but be absolutely comforted by the fact that I will be able to tell when you feel that enough's enough, you've heard it already. First of all, thank you for inviting me to give this talk. I'm proud and I'm honoured to do it. Jeanette is one of the people that I most admire in Queensland for what she has done with the library. I just said to her, if we ever get time for a coffee, which is a long time since we've had that one, I said, I suppose there'll be 100 new initiatives you're going to tell me about, because you've completed all the others and ticked them off, because she does get things done. So to come back to the Siganto Foundation, It's a great honour to be associated with the State Library of Queensland, and also particularly with the Australian Library of Art. Yes, we have been supporters for a long time, but some years ago there was just a feeling of, well, what about, and other things were mentioned among the group on the foundation, the directors of the foundation. So I came to the library and I said, could we be associated with one thing? It's not so much just the reporting back. The library has always been very good at that. But one thing where there's a little bit of involvement with it. And so as it's turned out, that I then became involved. And could I say to you that with the foundation, that personal involvement makes so much difference. Because you can bring back not only your impressions, etc., but with something like the Library of Arts, and when five of my children are in the community and they come back and told them that one of their friends went to the workshop or the seminar or on a visit here with their children, their school children or whatever, and that comes back to us, it just makes you feel that there is a that money has gone out into the community and is working to do something, which is all that we want to know that it is doing. So could I say how successful this has been and how very pleased I am with the association with the Australian Library of Art. And on the personal note, I really had not very much idea about the artist's books. I thought I had a glimmer of what was happening. And then with a certain work that somebody here was showing, I'm sure she wouldn't like me to mention her name, there was a breakthrough. But also by other people, by Peter Anderson, who was a fellow here and did a work on the ephemera. And there was quite a long description of that in iLine recently, where he pays tribute to the library. And also the two people who were here today, Jan and Douglas, who are going to talk about their work. This means so much to us because we know we're getting, what shall we say, the alignment with the library of art is something, but the personal understanding of it is something more important. If I could just say to you, you know, we're all brought up to look at things like landscape architecture, but the day when you're out and looking at some landscape and you start thinking of it through the eyes of one of the artists that you know and seeing it differently, that's when it's making an effect. And it's the same with the book. It could never be the same after this. Janet has said much the same thing, that it's the fact that the book is an artefact. It's just got so endless ramifications that it just makes it so much more important and means so much more to it. Well, after that, I would like to come to the two new fellowships, and I'm very proud to be here to announce them. The 2015 Siganto Artists Books Creative Fellowship in the second round is awarded to Anna Paula Estrada. Anna's fellowship will allow her to complete a project titled A Senior's Journal, Memories for Others. Anna Paula has a visual arts degree from the Autonomous University of the State of Mexico and has received multiple artists' grants and awards in Mexico and Australia. She has previously published two artists' books in 2014 and 2015 and has had her work published in regional magazines and newspapers across Australia. Anna Paula's work will use photographic family archives, poems, letters, newspapers, articles, food recipes, maps and autobiographical writings of older Australians to generate a journal on the history of Queensland's old residents. For somebody my age, can you imagine how appealing it is to read this being done? Could I ask you to join in with me in congratulating Anna Paula? Thank you. Hello. Anna, congratulations.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you.
The 2015 Siganto Artists Books Research Fellowship in the second round is awarded to Dr. Victoria Cooper. Dr. Cooper has a Doctor of Philosophy from James Cook University with research focusing on scientific image and its place in art and cultural narratives. She has also completed tertiary study in visual arts, photography, and biology, and has received numerous awards. Victoria has researched, written, and published in her areas of interest: artist books, the photo book, photography, and contemporary art practice. Her project will study selected works in the Australian Library of Art and identify the storytelling characteristics and elements of montage and underpinning the visual and textual narratives. I know a little bit about her work, and I'm very personally pleased that I'm going to give her this award today. Please join me in congratulating Victoria.
Thank you, Marie. Thank you. It's an absolute honour to be working with you and the library. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Marie, and the Siganto Foundation for your sponsorship of the Australian Library of Art. I think everybody would like to join with me in thanking Marie and congratulating our two new fellows. Right, I would now like to introduce our keynote speaker. Amir Brito Cadôr has flown from Brazil just to join us today for this seminar. Amir is a professor at the School of Fine Arts at the Federal University of Minas Gerais. He has a particular interest in artist books, which he publishes, researches, creates, exhibits, and performs. Amir also curates exhibitions, and he's the curator of a special collection of artist books at the Library of the School of Fine Arts. Amir was telling me that the collection is relatively new, just about 3 years old. They have 400 books which have already been catalogued, and they've got another 400 waiting cataloguing. So I think that's really an achievement to acquire such a collection in a short period of time. Let's move on now and welcome Amir to give his presentation.
Good morning. I would like to thank the Siganto Foundation and the State Library of Queensland for inviting me for this presentation. I'm honored to be here. I hope you like this presentation. It's based on an exhibition I made in Belo Horizonte in 2030. This presentation is based on the exhibition I made the curatorship 2 years ago. And I will read the presentation and I will try to stick to it in order to finish in time. Although it may be repeated or reenacted, each performance is a unique event which, most of the times, depends on the presence of the artist. Different from the theatrical enactment, the performance does not present the illusion of events, but on the contrary, it presents real events as a form of art. Many artists started to record such events in films, videos, photographs, tests, drawings, and scores. Such records frequently appear in the pages of artist books, artworks intentionally composed as the unfolding of the performance. The artist books are works of art that can follow us anywhere, in any time. I will show a group of artworks that are performance and books at the same time, so that what was temporary becomes permanent. What was unique can be indefinitely repeated. The page sequence of the book lasts longer than the performance, as if it were continuous or as reenacted every time the book is opened. I grouped the books in some sections according to some characteristics. The first one is the documents, the recording of a performance. Sometimes this recording may resemble a verbal account, a narrative, or a descriptive text that can be so detailed as to register every movement of the artist's body. In this book by Kenneth Goldsmith, he recorded each movement made during 13 straight hours of June 16, 1997. This day has been known as Bloom's Day, when the events lived by the character Leopold Bloom from the book Ulysses by James Joyce are celebrated. Kenneth Goldsmith attached a microphone to his chest and described all the movements made in a certain period of time, reducing the body to a catalogue of mechanical movements. Sometimes the publication space can be transformed into a physical space, into the place where an event happens, whether as a performance or exhibition. The Brazilian artist Antonio Manuel was supposed to make an exhibition in the Museum of Modern Art of Rio de Janeiro. The exhibition was denied by the censorship, so it occupied the pages of the journal. According to the artist, it was a period with censorship and craziness. Then I take the censored exhibition and transform it into iconographic material and gathered a couple of tests and created a newspaper-like structure, therefore inventing a new kind of platform to expose the prohibited works. Later on, I managed to have the result published in a six-page section of the journal, which made the exhibition function independently from museums, dictatorship, censorship, lasting 24 hours, which is the lasting period of a newspaper. The purpose of most of the documentation of the performance art is to make the work of the artist accessible to a bigger audience. And one of the most efficient ways to make that possible is the artist's publications. The documentation of a performance usually associates text and image because, in some cases, the photographs are not sufficient to reconstruct the action. But to the artist Marina Abramovic, the photograph or the video does not fulfill the real presentation of performance. There's always something missing. The photographs are associated to a verbal account, a descriptive text or narrative that may take the form of a diary, a biography, or a report. To those who see the photograph of a performance, the acquisition of the image is made through information, not experience. Some experiences are impossible to share with the audience, unless as an information. The book facsimile portrays photographs and notes from the artist Artur Barrio, making comments on a few of his actions. It is a copy of his notebooks, a personal record that mixes the description of an action and the sensations and thoughts of the artist while executing it. The biography of the architecture student Marcelo do Campo, written by Dora Longo Bahia, recover the performances, videos, and actions that supposedly took place between 1969 and 1975. The artist confounds on purpose document and artwork, showing the black and white photographic records as if they were authentic. The documentation is usually understood as a supplement of the work. The event needs the photograph as a proof or evidence to confirm that it actually happened. On this page, we see a frame from the video still attributed to Marcelo do Campo, which is a fake artist. He does not exist. He was invented by Dora Longo Bahia, who is a personage of this video. And this book is made after his research writing the biography of this false artist. Here is a group of her students using old clothes to look like an old photograph. all the images of the book were forged as to be attributed to someone else from another time, the actions that happened recently. We are facing performed photographs, cases in which the space of the document, whether visual or audiovisual, thus becomes the only space in which the performance occurs. Common or everyday situations, as riding a bicycle, sleeping, brushing teeth, smoking a cigarette, or climbing stairs, may also be a theme for performances. It is an attempt to bring art and life together, blurring the limits between the two domains, and at the same time, introducing a little humor to the circumspect world of art. In Last Day, the action lasts only a few seconds, in which Gilbert draws on a cigarette, looks down for a moment, and then turns to George. The brevity of the gesture is unnoticed in the instant that it happens, but the record makes the perception of a small but significant action possible. This is a work by Brazilian artist Leonora de Barros. It was made when she was 17 years old. It was published on a magazine in Brazil, a homage to the sculptor George Segal. Leonora de Barros transforms the action into something unexpected and poetic. The foam created by the toothpaste occupies the entire face and head of the artist, creating an amorphous white mask, as the piece is by Segal. In turn, David Horvitz pays homage to Bas Janade and enters the ocean riding a bicycle on a video that he attributed to the missing artist. The video was transformed into a flipbook. There is also the performed photography, or the performance for the camera. Some performances are conceived and reenacted with the photography as a goal, which implicates a technical accuracy much different from the precarious photographic records from the 60s and 70s. After all, the performing artist interested in preserving their work rapidly became aware of the necessity of acting for the cameras. Some books and plays are impossible to be played on a stage. Therefore, they only exist within the book, more than in other artists' books that somewhat deal with the performance. It is evident in this group of books a continuous variation between acting and presenting. The artists use graphic reading techniques to present a play that neither exists outside the book nor existed before the book was published. This book by the Brazilian artists Du, Beatriz and Claudia Jaguaribe is like a photo novel showing professional actors. It's a love plot with a theme of jealousy. There is also the books by Jonatas de Andrade and Iana Parente, a duo from the Northeast. They invited another duo of Brazilian artists to play a role. This book is based on Love and Happiness in Marriage, a book very popular in the 60s. And they use old books and use special techniques in the photographs to look like older. The book was sold in fascículos, and sometimes they can open up as a poster. Sometimes the artist herself is introduced as if she were a character or as part of a fictional narrative. The artist Rosângela Renault collected some newspaper news about a character named Rosângela. And with Alicia Pena Duarte, the text was rewritten as if they were a single character named Rosângelas. The Brazilian artist Greta, she used the body as an instrument of her work, presenting records of her own body in this series, Autofotos. The distortions produced by exaggerated facial expressions are deformed by the photographic manipulation, transforming the face into a mask. There is also the performance for the page. The performance for the page can be a collection of drawings, diagrams, or photographs that refer to the graphic space. The action takes place on the page of a book. Alan Capro, commenting on the photography as instruction for action, says it has a diagrammatic function. It is meant to condense in a most graphic way, along with words, a certain kind of informative structure. In his book Satisfaction, a telephone conversation is registered. It also functioned as a manual to reenact the performance. With two couple of artists. In some cases, a book with drawings may also be considered a performance. The book Manual de Boas Práticas, Good Practice Guide by Daniela Maura, is a reenactment of photographs that presents a couple interacting in different situations. The scenes were photographed and later drawn and transferred to the pages using carbon paper. The reproduction method was chosen to update in each exemplar the moment, the instant captured in the photographs. She's my wife, it's me here, as you can see. Michael Snow, in a famous book, Cover to Cover, he used the front and verse of the page as a metaphor for moving forward inside the book. The same aspect we can see in this contribution to the Art Forum magazine by the Italian Michelangelo Pistoletto. The representation of the artist's body on the page may consider both sides of the sheet as a unit, showing the artist both from the front and the back, as if the photograph, which has only two dimensions by definition, gained volume, even within minimal thickness. The work is just these four pages, the closed book. And there's another artist, Mary Dicho, during her short residence in Brazil, the North American artist made a contribution to the Brazilian magazine Corpo Estranho, The Strange Body. The work is a sequence of photographs showing the artist from four points of view. The images perform what the title describes, two pages and four sides. And sometimes the body of the artist can enter the graphic space literally through the use of photocopies of fragments of his body made on a Xerox machine. Paulo Bruschi calls his action zero performance. And he says that he made a partnership with the machine to produce the images. There's another Brazilian artist, a pioneer of the Xerox art in Brazil, named Udinilson Jr. He simulates the copulation with the machine in the series called Exercício de Me Ver, Seeing Me Exercise. And here you can see the image produced of his body. He was in the last São Paulo Biennale of Art. He died 2 years ago. In performances that were conceived for the page, the photography may go through graphic interventions and represent an action that did not actually exist. The photographic works of Luiz Carlos Retamoso is situated between the performance and the photography, in which the photography is not the record of live action, but the place where it happened. On this photographic poster, the artist was photographed spray painting a blank wall. The gestures only simulated the action, but the drawing was made with an aerographer over the printed paper. The spray painting surpasses the limits of the wall, occupying then the space of the page. The image may also be observed as a diagram of the action. The performance, The Mouth Tamer, O Domador de Boca, was played for the first time in 1976 by the Brazilian Ewald Granato, one of the pioneers of performance art in Brazil. He gesticulates, yells, eats, and vomits. Later on, this performance was repeated in a studio for a photo shoot made by Julio Wakahara. The Mexican artist Ulysses Carrion saw the photos and wrote a long single verse poem after seeing the photos. The poem reads, "Ewald Granato is the boa." An acetate sheet with a colorful circle printed on was inserted on the book before each photograph. On each situation, the circle graphically represents a different action, yell, eat, vomit, etc. John Baldessari, in this book, he shows each photo with a primary color horizontal line. Each color represents a specific movement that accompanies the displacement of hands and feet. The height of the lines is defined by the position of the artist in the photograph. As the pages move and the lines change, melodies and chords are produced, as the title indicates. Here is a picture from the exhibition in Brazil. The book sometimes does not show just a narrative, but the narrative happens on the page itself, which is evident in this theatrical play by Warren Lehrer and Dennis Bernstein, which is performed on the page of a book. The scenery is composed by icons, the graphic signs usually found in fast food dinners. Each character is represented by a different type of letter with a different color, and the position of the dialogues on the page corresponds to the actors on the stage. It's impossible to play this. And there's also the instructions and scores for performance. Another way to reach a bigger audience, despite geographic or time distance. Most artists from the Fluxus movement, like Robert Filiu, Mieko Shiomi, Benjamin Patterson, and Yoko Ono, made scores. Some of them wrote books with small texts that look like poems. In such cases, the book is no longer a product or result of an action, but a proposition or instruction to perform an artistic action. The artist Dick Higgins, who was a student of John Cage, was also a musician and composer. His scores combined drawings, photographs, and diagrams, accompanied by instructions for the execution of the plays. Another picture from the exhibition with the piano album Short Piano Pieces. In another work called Piano Sonata No. 2, it consists of a set of colorful acetate sheets with drawings of arrows of different size and positions pointing to numerous directions. The sheets should be placed on top of any kind of score for the piano. When the pianist finds an arrow, he can choose to follow it or not. An arrow pointing to the left indicates that the song should be played backwards. The onomatopoeias used in comic book stories are the theme of the scorebook Stripzodi by the Italian Eugenio Carmi. The book is accompanied by a vinyl compact with the audio of the score and a small glossary of onomatopoeias. The legacy of the 60s is updated in the proposals of young Brazilian artists that want to bring art closer to life, creating unpretentious artworks. Philippe Bittencourt repeated the task of thinking of a performance every day when waking up, and he made a drawing of it and posted it on a blog created for this purpose until 10 a.m. every morning. And so it happened day after day, page after page. The artist made 365 proposals of daily performance without, however, realizing any of them. Another work from Brazilian artist Fabio Moraes, he created a character named O Performer, the performer, and the test describes a special action made by this character. It's not a performance realized by the artist. It's just a test. It's shown only a printed test on the walls of the gallery. And after some exhibitions, the artist made this book. This is an interesting project. It's an exhibition, a portable exhibition, curated by Regina Belin, with 36 participating artists. Each artist was invited to submit instruction for an artwork to be done. And the name of the book is To Be Done, Por Fazer, also PF, the abbreviation of Por Fazer, is the name of a lunch in Brazil. The book has detachable pages, so you can carry with you and perform anywhere. A situation of exhibition of this book. This is a little known work of a Brazilian musicine. He was a founding member of the Brazilian avant-garde movement Poem Process. The movement made performances and happenings in the 60s and 70s, and the work circulated in publications by mail in a similar vein to that of the Fluxus artists. And it's a book with loose sheets with instructions for performance to be enacted. There is another kind of score, which is a map with indication of a route. The Argentinian artist Jorge Macchi presents 8 itineraries with 46 points chosen and documented through tests, photographic images, and audio information, also with postcards, letters, and stamps. The play emerges as an invitation for the reader to meet places through a guide that subverts the usual function of the tour guide to take a more apprehensive look over the path and day-to-day things. The reading as performance. This base de another book contains scenes of the performance The Boy Who Fell Over Niagara Falls. The 2 weeks reading of this incredible story, published on Reader's Digest, was performed at the Art and Project Gallery in Amsterdam. The boy mentioned in the title is the only person who fell over the Niagara Falls and survived. The book was published 20 years after the performance and reproduces the text read by Ader and the photographs of the artist in silence, seated on a chair with an open book. But if the performances implicates the real through the physical presence of the body, the reading of certain artist's book places the body in an active attitude, therefore performatic. Momento Vital is a cursive text that appears little by little at each page, until the conclusion of the idea. The first word is I, the last word is and. The artwork integrates the reader, the act of reading, and the book itself in the reader's hands. The book that has the reading as a theme has been presented on a performance by Vera Chavez in 1979. And reenacted only again in 2013. An artist's book is a type of work in which the meaning appears as the pages are turned, as we realize sequentially its structure. The new art of making books creates specific reading conditions. Another book by Giovanni Anselmo about the visual properties of the printed word. He promotes the physical encounter between the audience and the reading using only a few elements, a single word and the sequential movement of the page. At first, the word read becomes smaller each page until it disappears. As the pages of the book are turned, the sizes of the letters become so big that, in the end, the color black takes over the entire space of the page, and it becomes impossible to read. Another group of books is about actions. Using methodologies adopted by criminal investigators, the book Royal Road Test is the result of the collaboration between Ed Hiusha, Mason Williams, and Patrick Blackwell. The book shows the documentation of an old royal writing machine that has been tossed out of a car at the right speed. This book was used as a kind of score by the British artist Simon Morris, who made this another book, like a set of instructions. A group of students cut out all the words from the interpretation of dreams by Sigmund Freud, and the artist threw the words from the window of the car and registered in photographs the action. Sometimes the book is the result of an action. That's why I called it trace. The action may be done by the artist himself or can be done following the instruction left by him. This book by Solowit, Squares with Sides and Corners Torn Off, the title describes the images and at the same time they serve as a proposition. It is the starting point for the creation of images. On each page, a black square is shown with one of its corners torn off in all possible combinations. This book by George Matsiunas was published for the first time in 1976, and it was published posthumously 22 years later, following the instructions by the artist. The book did not present text or images except on the cover. Its content is the succession of destructive actions in its pages that were presented torn, crumpled, cut, clumped, with holes on, stained, or even glued. It's the terror of the library. This book is another example of destructive action on a book. It was made by the Brazilian Nuno Ramos. The title is a pun. It means shooting, but also means ballad. It is a book of 896 pages, and it was shot by the artist using two different guns. And the bullet is lodged around the page 700. It was made in an edition of 100 books. This is a curiosity. I thought that the artist was joking, and I bought 10 copies of this book to see if they were really different. They were. They were made with the hands of the artist, the stains of black paints in the fingerprints of the artist. The curious handling of the fingers of the artist of the blank, over the blank surface of the pages. As each reading is unique, there are no two equal exemplars of this book. The funny thing, it was offset printed. The artist Paulo Bruschi, alluding to the dance, left his shoe prints on the poster, Compassos em A2. The title refers to the format of the paper that was used in a series of books published by Regina Melin in Florianópolis, Brazil. Paulo Bruschi painted the sole of his shoes and danced over the page. Because A2 is the name of the format, but also in Brazil, the name of dancing with a partner is called A2. Another way of creating the tension between what is unique and what is multiple is observed in this book by Santiago Sierra, produced by a group of 30 unemployed workers hired by the author to do the performance El Trabajo es la Dictadura. The work is the dictatorship. The action consisted of repeated writing with a ballpoint pen during about 8 days the same phrase, El Trabajo es la Dictadura, on 1,000 copies of the book. This book was sold by the exact price used to make it. And finally, the performative. The term performative in the visual arts field is simply used to describe, identify, or quantify a certain artist's work that is related to the performance or that has attributes connected to the performance. On the following examples, the approximation between the book and the performance is done by a material structure that invites the reader to handle it. The book binding, or the lack of it, allows the book to be reconfigured by the reader through combinations from a limited group of terms, words, of image, or images. The reading is not just an intellectual action, a passive body attitude, but a gesture, a physical action, in which the turning of pages may bring a new drawing or a new test to the surface. The Italian Bruno Munari, in 1949, started creating unreadable books. At first, they were intended for children, books with no text and no images for anyone to read. These books use vibrant color pages, strangely cut to communicate through the forms and color. The Brazilian artist Raimundo Colares, who stayed a while in Italy, made a series of books named Gibi, the Brazilian name for comic book, using cut pages. The colored paper cut, you can see a new composition as the pages are turned. Here is another of his books in an unusual format. Jan Vos made a book without bookbinding. Here, this absence is fundamental. It shows on the left side of the page a person sitting and waiting for the bus, and on the right side appears the bus coming up. Another sheet inserted later, with just the road and the vegetation around, without any other element on the scenario. The other side of this sheet is identical, as if it were a continuation of the road. The book is sold in loose sheets. The more sheets you buy, the longer you wait for the bus to come. In Colido ou Escapo, the Brazilian poet Augusto de Campos proposes a composition exercise in which the vocabulary fragments meet and separate, sometimes forming known words and other times forming new, unpredictable ones. The loose sheets folded in half allow a constant reorganization of the words, forming new verses. It's like the poem emerged just in the instant that the book is handled. The title is Collide or Escape, taken from Lewis Carroll. This book by the Mexican artist Marta Elion has a specific book binding with two metallic spirals, and the book can be turned into a live wrestling. The stars delimit the space of the combat, the ring. Each page turned is a new pair in combat, a new fight. The images were taken from typographic cliches from wrestling posters owned by Marta. The Colombian artist Nicolas Paris made a book which consists of a series of drawings that can be transformed when the corner of the page is folded. That way, the drawing of a man may gain a hat. The projected shadow of a tree may change direction. New situations may happen at every turn. The rendering is required by the book, which has creased pages that are expected to be turned by the reader. At last, the book Poemobilis consists of 12 three-dimensional poems that invoke the reader to move its pieces. Augusto de Campos and Julio Plaza worked together in an effort to integrate text and image so that the handling of the cards with cuts and foldings reveal other texts, shapes and colors. The book highlights the process. As the title indicates, the poems and the mobile. When looking at this set of artworks, I realized that I still do not know how to answer questions made long ago. What can the body do? What can a book do? More than just answers, I hope that this test can produce more questions. Thank you.
Thank you, Amir. I just have to swap glasses so I can see. I think that has given us quite a few things to think about when we think about performance and artist books. I guess for many of us, we think of performance as involving the body and not just involving the turning of the pages and of the book. So I think we've had a really interesting introduction to performance and the book. And I think the other thing that we have been very fortunate to receive is what's going on in Brazil and in another country. And it's also interesting to see parallels that are happening within the book world that we know here in Australia as well. Does anybody have any questions for Amir following that paper? Jeanette.
At the university, we have a limit to the codex format because we have no much space to have the books. And also, I'm very interested in books in editions. In large editions, it's better for me because I can afford to pay. Most of the books at our collection were donated by the artists. And it is easier to get a book in editions. But the artist book is a very wide field. There's various kinds of books. I cannot say a limit. It's a book made by an artist. Sometimes we call book object to refer to books with a sculptural approach. Sometimes you use a term, the bookwork, to refer to a specific kind of artist book. But they all artist books. The important thing is a book made by an artist. A book made as a work of art, not only the reproduction of an artwork. I think it what fits to me.
Are there any other questions? Yes? Oh, we've got a mic. I think, have we got a mic?
Where those are concepts that you talked about in the slide, how do you see those applying to other mediums, and as such, where do you see those dynamic concepts that you talked about, where do you see those being applied to books and artifacts of artists in the future, more so things like on the web and like the net and like non-physical records of artists' creations. How do you see those being applied?
Well, I don't used to think about that because I'm very interested in the printed material. And I don't even think about the book, the electronic book. Some researchers says that the electronic book isn't a book either. It's just a text, a digital file. And the book, I'm interested in handling the book, turning the pages, the material aspects. And I don't have much to say about the electronic and the new mediums.
Say, if you take the aspect of like it's as a performance, so you could interact with it in a similar way that you could with a physical book. You could interact with a slideshow or like a website, and even if you had like an ephemeral quality to it, so it's only available for a few weeks, and kind of like the Fluxus movement and the performance art, where they were trying to get away from a physical thing, but then it turned into a physical thing, something like that.
Yes, I think it's a whole new field, but it's more connected to the performance and less connected to the book. And my approach to performance was, because my wife works with photography and performances, and we have a lot of books, and we started to talk about the space of the performance in the printed book. So I'm not a specialist in performance. I made this research only for the exhibition, and I was interested only in this approach of the performance in books.
Thanks, Amir. That was a fantastic presentation, and it's, as Jeanette said, it's just taken my concepts completely, I mean, just blown my concepts out, because I thought I was getting a grasp of what artist book can be, but you know, it's just, I can't even comprehend. So my question is, or that is something that just crept in my head, so would you say that art, the books, the standard books, or the bigger genre of books, is a subset of artist books? Or vice versa?
Ulysses Carrion, one of the first thinkers of this new field of artist books, he likes to say that the artist book should look like the ordinary book. To him, the artist book, the books made in the 60s and 70s, which he called bookworks, they were not like sculptural books. He said they must resemble a common book, ordinary book. Stick it to this definition. I think that the ordinary book could be an artist book. It depends on the intention, it depends on the, I think there's a circulation of the artwork. Sometimes it coincides with the ordinary book, sometimes it's very different. Ulysses Carrion says that each artist book has their own theory to study it. And it's very hard to me to find a general description. I need to grab the book in my hand and see it and see how it works and say it's an artist book or not.
This one at the back, Mary. G'day, Amir. My name's Tim. Thank you very much. That was very informative. One of the things that was very evident to me was that most of the books you presented were mechanically reproduced. By machines or offset, etc. You indicated your how you are able to purchase or acquire books limit what you can purchase. As someone who's aware of the broad presence of the handmade book in Australia, could you give us some indication of the presence and its comparison to the mechanically printed book and the handmade printed book in Brazil?
In Brazil, we have many artists working with handmade books, mostly of them comes from the printing making field. Artists who use it to make albums of prints, and sometimes they turn to the book, to the bookbinding. It's crescent, but it's not a field established in Brazil today. There's a few artists working with the bookbinding. In Brazil, seems like two different fields. People who are interested in the printed editions in offset or digital printed works has places specific for them, for the exhibition, the production, and the artist book fair. And there's another circuit for the handmade book, which is from the galleries. They usually don't go to the artist book fair. I don't know why, but most of artists in Brazil, when we talk about artist book, thinks only in the artisanal work. The printed in large editions is something new to most of the Brazilian artists. But they have been produced since the 70s. Ulysses Carrion, when came to Brazil in the 70s, saw a book by Vladimir Dias Pino, who is one of the founding members of the poem process. And he said that the first examples of artist books were made in Brazil from the concrete poetry movement, which Vladimir was one of the exhibitors in 1956. But he was living in Cuiabá, who is a small city. Even in Brazil, when we spoke about Cuiabá, it's a city with nothing known about that city in Belo Horizonte or São Paulo or Rio. It's very isolated. Vladimir, when worked there, he used to print himself his books using the offset machine. And he had an approach, artisanal, to this industrial process. Also, Aloysio Magalhães, another pioneer in Brazil, produced in 1957 in Philadelphia with Eugenie Feldman, a work of a book work named Doorway to Portuguese, which has an artisanal approach to the printing process. The Eugenie Feldman says that the printing machine was like a brush for him. I don't know if I answered your question.
Thank you. I think we'll call it a day. We have morning tea waiting for us on the Queensland Terrace, so if you would like to join us then. And if I could ask everybody to come back into the auditorium by 11:30, and we'll start with our reports from the Siganto Foundation Fellows. So thank you, Amir. We've had our eyes opened. Thank you.